This video has been supported by Skillshare. Hey there, CNC friends. This is not a CNC machine, but it's full of chips and it's very accurate, so maybe you'll like it too. I'm currently repairing it. That'll take a bit more time, so I thought today we could start gently by doing something similar with volts, ohms, PPMs and so forth. For that, a quick look back to 2018. I repaired a Solartron 7081 8.5-digit precision voltmeter, and I thought about modifying it a little bit. But I didn't dare. It was the best voltmeter in my arsenal until now, and that says something being surrounded by all those Keithleys. But now, not a CNC machine has moved in, and effortlessly took the prestigious position of highest end instrument. That doesn't mean that the good life is over for Solartron. Quite the contrary. It's finally getting some dignified playmates and the chance to do what it's good at. That's right, it's actually not just a decorative backdrop for silly YouTube videos. Oh no, I'm also measuring voltage references with it, once a year or so. Remember these beauties? I remember. The LTZs were powered on permanently since I made their video, so they should be ripe now. And that's precisely what Solartron is good at determining. It can measure the infamous 7.1-something output voltage all the way down to nanovolt. You just gotta give it a minute for one of those 8.5-digit readings. That's not a problem though, because usually you're not hand-holding probes while eagerly waiting for a result. As a matter of fact, no holding hands necessary at all. 7081 is not the youngest voltmeter anymore, but still perfectly capable of working alone for a few hours, thank you very much. Preferably in a calm and temperature-stable environment. You can let it take measurements all day long and recall the statistics program afterwards. In terms of variance and standard deviation, it mockingly told me that, oh, you did your best, son, and you made an okay voltage reference. Maybe try again when it has aged for 40 years like mine. Hey, does anybody else feel that? My inner clock says it's almost teardown time. So, we've got an 11 microvolt standard deviation. That's great for a voltage reference. But other builders of this pretty much maxed out multi-hundred dollar insanity module are reporting much better results. So, where's the problem? Well, I got too close and caught the highly infectious voltnut disease. That's where it all started to go wrong. But I just configured a similar long-term experiment with an even more trustworthy voltage source, one that I didn't DIY. That gave me an even worse reading, so now I've got a pretty good idea on whose fault that is. First of all, it's not a big deal. These are not first world problems. These are absolutely esoteric ivory tower problems. So no hard feelings towards this absolutely esoteric ivory tower voltmeter that somehow managed to be this awesome in the 1980s. I love the enclosure, even though it's not metal. I think this thick, fiber-reinforced molded plastic provides better thermal insulation for the insides than sheet metal could. It also doesn't have grills or even cooling fans, further improving thermal stability and letting absolutely no dust in. The lid is coated conductively and connected to mains earth when closed. That doesn't seem to be enough because for the sensitive analog area, there's an extra shielding PCB that gets connected to a floating guard node in a similar way. The front panel is a piece of art, absolutely no sign of yellowing in the high-quality plastic. And have you ever seen a foil membrane keypad that still works like new after 40 years? It's a miracle. But it's gotta come off. There's one little thing I'd like to change. For that, I've gotta unplug a few connectors and desolder a speaker. Let go, Mr. Speaker. Then only the main input connector is left. It's attached to the front rear switch with fancy Teflon isolated cables. Teflon alone being great against leakage current and high voltage breakdown. Not at all against triboelectric noise as I thought before. But internal cables are supposed to be stationary, so that's all perfect. Every metal junction in the signal path is a potential source of unwanted nanovolt. So if we were completely dead serious, we could eliminate the front rear switch in favor of the truest possible signal. But that would be butchery. I'm aiming for something nicer. You can guess if you've seen my last video about this thing. This connector area is just an insert. Very lucky. I only just realized that I've shown this exact same measurement before in the Keithley 181 video. So chances are that some of you may have forgotten too. Here's a quick refresher. Solartron original input cable. Unwanted microvolt offset, in spite of luxury Swiss-made Fischer connector. Not very good. These are Pomona 3770 low thermal EMF binding posts. Directly gold-plated tellurium copper, no evil nickel layer in between. Those would be a perfect match for this instrument. I only have to find a way to fabricate a new insert. Hey, good news! Datron have just sent over not a 1281 8.5-digit voltmeter. They are not making those anymore, sadly. But some of their futuristic, balanced, single-flute end mills. Those are absolutely deadly razor-sharp, so a little band-aid dispenser is also a very thoughtful thing to include. I'm not going to hijack this rare test gear video to turn it into a CNC episode halfway through. So here are just a few impressions. This is a surprisingly non-easy part because it has two planes and it needs three or four separate operations. With the Heimer 3D probe, reclamping is not a problem though. And with a Datron end mill, aluminium stock effortlessly turns into a nice and uniform stream of chips. With good chip load and surface speed settings, I'm also having fewer problems with powdery chips. This should have been a single pass with a part clamped at an angle. But I chose the lazy way, and it took like 15 minutes of machine time to make this micrometer staircase. And so forth. It's unexciting when everything just goes according to plan. Time for yours truly to truly mess it up. Maybe pull the part out of the vise with cutting forces. No? Maybe drill too deeply and break through the front. Nope, still came out flawlessly. Well, the way I see it, I only have one option left. I'm going to try and anodize it, without ever having anodized anything before. That's an almost guaranteed disaster. For that, I'm suspending it on aluminium wire, in diluted sulfuric acid. I'm researching time and current parameters in YouTube tutorials, while the thing is already cooking. After collecting a lot of contradicting data for an arbitrary amount of time, and watching someone build a directional Wi-Fi antenna out of jar lids, I'm just plopping it into a preheated anodizing dye solution. There we go. Finally, it's nice and ugly. But at least it's got a very hard surface. And gold and violet go well together, kind of like a click spring project. I'll try this again later. For the purposes of this video, it's good enough that I got the dimensions right. The original connector has only 5 pins. High, low, resistance high and low, and guard. For the sake of symmetry and maybe a shielding box later, I've added another hole for mains earth. But I wouldn't want to waste another low thermal EMF connector on that one. Okay, that was kind of the intro. What I actually wanted to talk about in this video are the insides. A lot has happened since this thing was designed. How can it still be relevant? Well, it's right there at the beginning of their manual. DC voltage stability, 6 ppm per year. While not universally accepted, these meters are known to be a bit noisy, for example, one doesn't make such a claim without foundation. Considered by many to be the gold standard today, even a 3458A can only guarantee to be better than that with a special high stability option. Although much better results are reported for this meter routinely. And it gets even better, literally. When treated right, metallic resistors and Zener voltage references have a tendency to get more and more stable over time. The Solartron Schlumberger 7081 in front of me uses this property better than any other voltmeter out there. Probably not really, but as far as I know. To make sure that nothing can interfere with the nice square root shaped aging process, this thing is absolutely full of hermetically sealed components. And I'm not talking about these no doubt fancy molded plastic resistors. Oh no. TO metal cans, all hermetic. Koto reed relays. This one looks a bit like a JB Weld botch, but it's actually an original. They all have at least a glass tube in them. Only the magnetic coil and optional shielding and guarding are outside. Even these guys. When first I opened the meter, I asked you if I should replace all the caps that have survived for 40 years with modern planned obsolescence parts that will start leaking in 10. Well, I almost did it, but then I realized what they are. Military and aerospace, solid tantalum hermetic caps. Absolutely not preventive maintenance replacement candidates. They even used some of them on the logic boards. The highlights on this board are the gray barrels. Those are hermetic, nitrogen-filled precision wire wounds. Made by MAN Components in the UK shortly before being acquired by Vishay. Absolutely incredible parts with multiple glass-to-metal seals and a few interesting advantages over today's thin-film technology. EEV Block forum member Slimax has accumulated quite a fascinating collection of standard resistor photos, including something very similar to my gray barrels. I'll link that down below. That entire board on the right is called Printed Circuit Board 6. Maybe Analog Front End would be a more modern name. If you are curious about this kind of thing, the service manual is public, complete, and very well written. In short, this board is a variable voltage divider that turns a maximum 1kV input voltage into something a little bit more manageable. For smaller signals, there is a variable gain amplifier that is actually built discretely but summarized on this sheet. Then the signal is handed over to Printed Circuit Board 5, where a fully discrete analog-to-digital converter is waiting. It's actually based on a shockingly simple integrator that measures how many clock pulses it takes for a certain capacitor voltage to surpass a reference voltage. Not the reference voltage, however. They are using that to bias the signal to be measured, so that there is some safety distance to zero. Then it can just be calibrated out because it's always the same. Or is it? D301 on this sheet is the main voltage reference, and it's looking a bit lonely there, isn't it? The AD590 right next to it is a temperature sensor on the basis of which they are adjusting the Zener current ever so slightly. That way they are apparently counteracting thermal effects successfully. But come on, it's just freely standing there out in the open. They haven't even coiled the leads, as was good practice, to absorb minute tectonic forces from the board. After learning a bit about subsurface ovenized LTZ1000s, I'm not so sure about this arrangement anymore. It's not like somebody is going to release a cold draft inside your instrument during a critical measurement, or at any other time, but you know, the difference is kind of huge. As in 150 microvolt versus immeasurable. Again, if you're interested in that kind of thing, check out the entire article on xdevs.com and everything else too for that matter. In short, this thing is an absolute monument to stability, except for a so-called LT flu, which we are going to meet shortly. And a $100,000 Josephson voltage standard, there is no better voltage reference out there. It's that good because on the same die, in the same hermetic package, there's a buried Zener diode, two transistors and a heater resistor. One of the transistors is actually used as a temperature sensor inside the metal can, whereas the other one controls the Zener current. External configuration resistors have little influence over the performance. And since even those have been fitted with Vishay's high-end Z-foil technology, the mythical 1 ppm per year drift should be doable. Okay, here's the plan. I'm going to implant this module into Solartron to replace its lonely little Zener diode. 7081 expert Mikkel has documented what a seamless, almost effortless mod that can be. It could even be reversed if it doesn't work out well enough. But before judging, it'll need some more time to acclimate. It would have been wise to test the influence of the binding posts and the voltage reference separately. But then again, this video was meant to be nothing but a fun little diversion, while I was waiting for parts for not a CNC machine. I should probably finish repairing that before letting it participate in these long-term experiments. After only an hour, it was clearly not done warming up, but the increased standard deviation from 20 to over 500 was still a bit of a shocker. It would also be interesting to try and change the ref amps that turn the reference voltage into plus minus 10. They are OP07s now. Nice op amps, but there are numerous better candidates today. Another hour later and we are down to 84 micro. What do you think? Will we get better than the initial 21 micro? I'll keep you up to date. Until then, take a look at Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community that offers a membership with meaning. There is a lot to explore there, real projects to create, and a community to be a part of. Skillshare offers classes designed for real life, so you can move your creative journey forward without putting life on hold. You can learn and grow with short classes that fit even the busiest of routines, like DSLR photography with Justin Bridges. Most of these skills not only apply to DSLR cameras, so in less than 1 hour and a half you're getting better pictures out of virtually all cameras. With an annual subscription costing less than $10 a month, Skillshare is also incredibly affordable, especially when compared to pricey in-person classes and workshops. The first 500 to sign up with the link in the video description are getting 2 months of premium membership for free. So give it a try and explore your creativity. That's it for now. Thank you for watching. And don't do this on a desk, by the way. I've got little specks of sulfuric acid everywhere now.